Since 1907, the picturesque Renaissance Studios on West 57th Street in Midtown, New York, have been the scene of significant artistic activity. Well-known artists have lived and worked in these spacious studios with a grand northern exposure, including Child Hassam, Irving Wiles, James Carroll Beckwith, Charles Baskerville, and others. Today, the Portrait Institute occupies the former Carroll Beckwith residence and studio on the 11th and 12th floors. In this stately room, Beckwith worked and entertained a circle of friends that included the great John Singer Sargent, whose work is the subject of our demonstration. Painting replicas of masterpieces is fun as well as excellent practice and training. John Singer Sargent, the artist of the painting I'm about to do for you, himself copied masterworks by the artists he admired, Velasquez, Henry Rayburn, and Frans Hals. I earnestly recommend this study method to you. In 1890, Sargent toured Egypt, Greece, and Turkey to prepare himself for the murals he had been commissioned to paint for the Boston Public Library. Part of the immense scheme of decorations called for a panel of Old Testament prophets. This study of an Arab was part of that preparation. Let's see what lessons we can learn. Where did the artist begin? I would suspect that his first stroke was here, in the shadows of the face. I'm going to start using a number 10 sable cat's tongue brush, a little bit of mineral spirits, and I'm going to mix the darkest, warm dark that I can come up with. I'm going to use burnt umber and a touch of ultramarine blue and also a touch of alizarin crimson. The shadow that Sargent has used there is extremely dark and looks almost like black. And I'm going to start by using that very dark mixture. It may look like black to you, but the presence of the alizarin crimson gives it just a touch of warmth. And next time we're in the Boston Museum, we'll have to take a close look at the original to see just how warm or how cool that shadow tone is. But in any case, the shadows are very dark, so dark that you, looking at the reproduction that I'm looking at, you can see very little detail. And I'm going to go ahead and paint that shadow tone almost like an undetailed poster area. Go right over to the edge of where the turban will be, leaving a little area of light where the light strikes the white of the eye. And then we come down onto to the cheek. The dark cuts around the bottom edge of the nostril. It comes down to outline the highlight on the mustache. And all of this over here is going to be just that deep, sort of mysterious dark. When I get down to the area of the upper lip, we're going to use that in the shadow tone on the upper lip. It curves out to define the light on the lower lip. There is a small, just a small shape of extreme dark between the lower lip and the beard. And then that shadow tone curves out around the light on the beard and starts to disappear into the reflected light on the beard. Okay, let's go back though, and any area that we see that is in that extremely dark shadow, we're going to go ahead and paint. Again, it's almost like a poster tone. There are no variations in my treatment of that shadow. We may add variations later, but Sargent apparently painted that dark shadow very, very simply. So much so that in a dim light, it might even look like a black shadow. Let's go ahead and add a little bit of ultramarine to our color. And we're going to skip down past the area of the beard to where the head casts a shadow on the shoulder. And we're going to continue with that dark. And we use it to outline the edge of the beard. We come on down to the rib cage and over against the edge of the collar. A little bit of ultramarine, a little bit of black, and right on the edge of the shoulder, a very dark passage of that same color. All right. Now, anything else of that color on the face? I would say that we could use a touch of it over here in the dark of the eyebrow. Between that and the eye itself is an area of lighter shadow, so we'll leave that unpainted. Put a touch of this extreme dark into the corner of the eye socket, and then we'll come down and put it right on the area of the iris of the eye. And we'll let that stand for the eye for now. We'll have to come back and change that. All right, there's our dark use of that shadow. Oh, two other small touches. One, a shadow on the mustache. And a very important one in the corner of the mouth. Now remember what this mixture is. It's basically burnt umber with ultramarine blue, alizarin crimson, and occasionally I've added touches of black to it. All right. We want to keep going with our shadow tones. I'm going to reach for a slightly larger brush, a bristle brush this time, and we're going to paint the shadows up there on the turban. We want to get all of our shadow tones painted first in as simple a way as we can. And I'd say the shadow on the turban could be painted just as a very dark gray. And I'm using ivory black and a touch of one of three neutral grays that I keep here on the palette for just purposes like this. Using the darker of the three, the what I call neutral seven with a little bit of black added to it. I'm going to go in here and paint the shadow tone where it curves up over the top of the turban, the fold in the turban. And then where that fold casts a shadow on this other portion of the turban, we'll indicate that with this dark tone. I know that for you that are observing, this tone probably looks as dark as that one, but it's not. It's slightly lighter. It has a touch of white in it. And then as we come down the turban, the color gets slightly lighter. I'm going to add a bit more of the neutral gray. In effect, all I'm doing is adding white. And we'll come down and articulate that fold in the turban. We'll try to draw the shape of the turbine where it meets the background. And then we'll bring that right down to the shadow on the face and try to get that bottom edge. And then we'll just sort of fill this in poster style, just as we did the dark on the face. Our discipline is to get the shadow tones painted wherever we see them before going on to something else. All right, we have the shadow on the face, we have the shadow on the turbine. The other shadows on the turbine are so light that we'll save that for a later passage. I think let's jump down to the tone on the beard. Since we have the neutral gray on the brush, we're going to lighten it just slightly with a little more neutral gray using the middle of the three neutrals now. And here we go to indicate the area on the beard, which is in a mysterious area of secondary or reflected light. It's grayish there, and as it comes down here and picks up the reflection from the yellowish robe that the man is carrying, we're going to add some yellow ochre for that. It's the same tone, basically, but warmed up with the yellow ochre, and I've lightened it just a touch with a bit of white for this area of reflected light. And we're not really going to blend the tones at all. We're just going to put them on in a simplified sort of a mosaic way. In a mosaic, the colors are kept separate from one another. There's no way you can blend a mosaic. And oil color, of course, blends so easily that it's kind of a discipline to try to restrain from blending too soon in the painting. Okay. With that same color on the brush, we want to go up to those lighter shadow tones on the turbine. And I see a touch. I'm looking at the painting, the original, and I see a bit of warm, almost orangey reflected light in that shadow up here. Touch too light. I'm going to darken that a bit. All right. It has an orange glow, and I've used cadmium orange for that. It's just a little touch there in the corner of the turbine. And we'll press the color out of the brush and get a thin knife edge so that we can do that passage and unite the two areas, the warm and the cool shadow. And then we'll just indicate that stroke right there. And lightening it up still further, a bit of white and a bit of cadmium orange, we can indicate the little shadow right there in a fold on the turbine. But let's keep going on our shadow tones. I'm going to use a smaller sable brush, a bit of burnt umber and burnt sienna for the shadow on the forehead that the turbine is casting. Darker than that, a little bit more burnt umber. I'm using a fairly wide brush, but I'm able to use it on the knife edge for the narrow part of that shadow. And then the turban curves over the forehead, and there's a bit more shadow right here along the cheekbone. Okay. That color is almost, if we lighten it just slightly, the color that we need in the shadow of this eye socket. And let's go in and put that in very simply and directly and in an uncomplicated way. And I think that we can go ahead and drop some of that color into this, the one area in this deep area of shadow that catches the light over here. All right, now we've almost done our shadow tones. Let's look and see what else is required. Well, we've got to do that great, large, important shadow here on the that the robe casts on his neck and rib cage. So let's go back to our mixture of burnt umber. And I'm going to take burnt sienna this time because it's on flesh. It's a shadow tone this time with lots of warm reflected light in it. And let's try burnt umber and burnt sienna. I'm going to try it first. And it's too reddish, so we'll go back to burnt umber and we'll add a little bit of ultramarine blue and we'll try it again. Still too light. I think the thing to do is to wipe off what I did and try again with adding alizarin crimson. And we want to do that stroke boldly and with sort of a dry brush edge the way Sargent did on his paint, without fussing with it. We need to indicate where it goes over the scapula right there. Okay. And I suppose we should even indicate the shadow tone down here. We can't complete that shadow right now because that will require the color on the rib cage there. All right, so there's our shadow tones. Before we can go further, I think we need to get the background on, at least an indication of it. So I'm going to take a big brush. This is a number 10 bristle filbert. And there are only two mixtures that I'm going to do. I'm going to do the dark tone on this side, and where it passes over the top of the head, it'll get lighter, and then a light tone on this side. So dark and light. And we'll start with just ivory black. And white. And we'll mix a big area of that. Now that looks a little too dark. Let's lighten that up. And we'll throw in a touch of yellow ochre to give it a slightly greenish cast. Maybe just a touch of viridian, just a touch to push it toward the warmer green. It's a very subtle greenish gray. Let's try that out up here. It looks just like plain gray, and we need to give it a little bit of a color character, so I'm going to put a bit more viridian in it, and I'm going to wipe that off and try that again. Now it seems too greenish, so we'll try to gray that down by adding white and black. All right, let's go with that, at least for the underlying tone. Now, we've heard eyewitness accounts of Sargent's procedure, in which he recommends that that everything be painted opaquely. He did not paint thick and thin the way a lot of artists like to do. And my suspicion is that if we had the original painting right here with us, we would see that this background color was laid on in a fairly opaque manner. I don't think it's just a wash. But he uses it to draw the top of the turban there. And we're going to lighten that in just a moment. And where he comes over here against the tone of the background, it's just sort of a a rough dry brush edge, and I'm going to use a combination of my hand and the edge of the brush to make that an informal dry brush edge. I don't want it to be careful or precise or rigid. Now, as we come in toward the turban, it has to be darker. I'm going to take a little bit of ivory black, a little bit of burnt umber. And we want to use this, if we can, the same big strokes that Sargent seems to have done in the study. And they come that way, and one of them has a kind of a blunt end. And then as we come right over against the turban, we've got to be careful because we want to draw the shape of the turban. We use just the edge of the brush to do that. Come up over here and get that shape and around like that. And there's a little prominence there on the top of the turban, and it's basically like that. Now, as it comes in right into the corner of the where the head meets the shoulder, it seems to get warmer. I've put a little bit of burnt umber in there. And then it has to be darker right there. So we'll add some, maybe some ultramarine blue and a touch of burnt umber. And let's see how this will look, right? It should be darker than that. I'm going to add some black to it. A good strong dark there. And we'll sort of feather that up into the background. And we don't want to fuss with that too much because it looks like, just to blend it a bit there, it looks like Sargent painted it very boldly and very simply. And in fact, he left a spatter of a stroke there and one there. Much more important, and I'm going to reach over here and clean off my brush, is the fact that where it comes across the top of the turban, it begins to get lighter. So I'm going to add white and yellow ochre. And we'll test that degree of lightness there. It seems about right. We'll carry that right up to the edge and off the edge of the canvas. And around here once again. Now it seems too dark. So I'm going to add white and yellow ochre. Okay. This is a very simple passage. It's just a big poster area with a very dry brush, unstudied edge. There's no rhyme or reason. And he obviously intended to leave this as a vignette. This is not a completed painting. This is a rapid study done in the vignette style, which means that that ragged edge around the outside is left that way. That's the way, if you go to the Boston Museum, that's the way it looks today. He did what he had to do and then laid his brush down. And it's a particular style of study. And it can be very appealing. Some people might look at it and say, oh, he didn't finish. Well, he didn't really. It's a study. And of course, when he did the mural painting, for which this was a preliminary, of course, the mural is quite finished. But the vignette style gives a feeling of immediacy to a painting. And all artists have used it in one way or another. Now I'm just going to take my finger and blend where the turban and the background meet. It is not a sharp edge there. It's not a focused edge. It's a slightly indefinite edge. And that's really all there is to that background. Okay, now, oil painting is an opaque medium, which means we work from dark to light. We've done our dark shadow tones, wherever they occur. Now we've put in the background, which gives us a setting. That brings us now to the painting of the halftones, the most important part of the painting. And I'm going to begin with the halftones, the transition halftones that lie along the edge of the shadow. And I think we'll start right here on the forehead. It's a warm, dark flesh tone. I'm going to start with burnt umber, a little bit of dark neutral gray. It's a subtle transition color. Let's try this and see how it looks. Not too bad. Let's go ahead and try it. This is a transition tone that'll get us out of the shadow area into the light area. All that is burnt sienna and neutral 7 over there. All right, let's add a little bit more burnt sienna, maybe a touch of Venetian red, first time we've used the Venetian red. And we're going to come down here and use some of that same color right along the shadow edge of the nose, and it will be just a small little sliver of tone. And I'm using the knife edge of the brush in order to paint it. Just a little sliver of tone right along the edge of the shadow. You may not even be able to see that it's there. And we're going to use that same color for the little passage on the nostril where the light hits the nostril. All right, we'll come on down with that. A little touch of that color here on the upper lip beneath the nose, and a little touch of it here in the shadow of the upper lip. I'm going to lighten it just slightly by using some neutral gray. And I'm going to come down here and put a touch of it on the upper lip. And more importantly, I'm going to paint an entire plane here on the under edge of the lower lip. Now, this is still that combination. It's burnt sienna and neutral 7, a little touch of it there in the corner of the, just above the beard, below the lower lip. And a little touch of it in the shadow of the turban on the forehead. All right, let's clean that brush and more vivid transition tones. I'm going to paint the transition tone on the nose and out onto the cheek. So, let's start with burnt sienna again. Let's lighten it with yellow ochre. Now, this is an important color, and it's going to set the tone for the whole central third of the face. The subject has a wonderful, warm, swarthy flesh tone. He's been out in the sun a great deal, and it glows with a kind of a coppery warmth. And burnt sienna, Venetian red, and yellow ochre. Now, as I put that on, it looks fine, but it looks a little bit brilliant, and so I'm going to gray it down. Whenever something seems excessively brilliant or intense, all I do is dip into one of those three neutrals, and that will take a little bit of the intensity out. I don't know if you can see that it has done so, but it has. This is more grayish than the more intense color right next to it. And we'll use this tone again. We're transitioning out of the extreme dark into the light. And we'll go up and add a little bit of this very much more pungent tone to the edge of the previous transition tone. And it looks to me like if we gray it down a bit, we can come on down and use it almost verbatim on this plane right beneath where the... Nope, I'm wrong. It needs to be grayed down. I'm going to add some neutral to it. And that will give us the transition out of that dark shadow into the light there on the lower third of the face. But I'm eager to get into these two halftones in the important light struck planes of the face. And let's do that now. I think we'll begin by mixing this large area of color. I'm going to use burnt sienna, touch of Venetian red, yellow ochre, and I'm going to lighten it up this time. I'm going to put a touch of white and a touch of cadmium orange to really make it glow. And don't be in a hurry. Take your time to adjust the mixture. And there's no reason why I can't test the mixture against my original. And it seemed that that test tells me it needs to be slightly darker, a little bit more Venetian red, and a little bit more neutral gray. Let's try it now. This is the half tone beneath the highlight on the cheekbone. Now, I suspect that that is going to look more brilliant maybe than it should. And I'm inclined to leave it, though, because this is going to be the intense, eye-catching center of the painting. And let's leave it for now. We can gray it down later, and I'll show you that. Let's leave that very intense and ruddy right now. It comes down to the top of the mustache, and it's defined by a highlight here and a highlight there, which will put on a little bit later. We'll darken it just a touch as we come up here into the trough between the eye and the nose. Now, I wish I could remember to tell you each time the brush that I'm using, but I want you to use a brush that is ever so larger than you might feel is appropriate. The bigger the brush you can use, the more effective the painting will be, particularly at this stage where you're trying to get a very simplified statement of these halftones. So I'm using a fairly big brush. It's a number 10, and I'm using it on the knife edge for the small strokes and on the flat for the larger strokes. And let's keep going with this tone. I'm going to lighten it just slightly, add a little bit of yellow ochre, and spread it all over the light plane of the nose, all the way down to the base of the nostril. And I'm going to try to leave that catchlight on the nose the way a watercolor painter would. A watercolor painter would leave the white of the canvas showing for that catchlight, and I'm going to leave the tone of the canvas showing. All right, I'm going to use the same color. I'm going to gray it down just a touch and go up here on the forehead. That's the strokes on the forehead seem to come diagonally down this way, and I'm feathering them a little bit in the opposite direction just for variety. And as I get out toward the center of the forehead, the color seems to get lighter and a bit more toward yellow ochre. One thing I'm not trying to be at this point is careful in any way or meticulous. Because that's not important. It's not important, first of all, to the spirit of Sargent's very direct style, and it's not important to this study, because this is a rapid, impressionistic kind of study. And it's not based on the meticulous way that's painted. And let's go over and use some of this color to the left of the highlight on the forehead and down the side of the forehead behind the eye. And it's starting to take on a little bit too much of an orangey look. So let's gray it down, neutral gray and yellow ochre. And that changes the character of the color quite a bit. And we'll paint that right into the eye socket, leaving the lightest areas for our next stage. We'll lighten that just a touch and bring it across the top of the forehead and down this way. All right. That color, we can go on here beneath the nose and put on the little touch of upper lip that we see just before the mustache. And if I take a very much smaller brush, and I'm going to use my mall stick now, I'm going to take that same color and go down here and paint it on the central plane of that lower lip. And this I'm going to do fairly carefully, because using the mall stick to steady my hand, because I want to get the drawing character of that lower lip while I put the color on it. And we can darken it just a touch. And again, leaving the highlight showing as the toned ground of the canvas, will complete the rough treatment of that lower lip area. All right, transition halftones and halftones that are not transitions. Let's simplify this area between the eye and the bridge of the nose. I've taken a lighter version of the tone I've been working with. We'll just come down the nose with that. And we want to leave that triangular area of glistening highlight for our next stage. And we want to leave this big area of highlight on the forehead. Let's see if we can define the shape of it a little better. And so forth. All right, now those are basically the halftones on the head. Let's attend to the halftones otherwise. How about up here on the turban? I think all I need is my middle neutral. Let's try that. Is that tone darker than the background? Yes, which means I need to use a darker neutral and maybe just a touch of blue in it to make it interesting. This half tone on the turban should be darker than the background. And so as I put it, just slightly darker though, not a lot darker, just slightly. So I'm watching that as I put the tone on. How does it relate to the background? And I'm going to blend that tone ever so simply. And I'm going to reshape the shadow above the top of it. It's just a little touch of darker tone on the shadow side of the turban, and that carries over into this area of the turban. I'm just using black and white now. And we'll define that, we'll use that tone to define the edge of the brow ridge and the shape of the cheekbone there. And that's really all there is to that. All right, other major transition tones. Okay, there's a terribly important one on the beard and the mustache, and let's do that now. I'm going to take black and white and yellow ochre for a very light tone, but it's an important one. It needs to be grayer than that. I'm going to add some more dark neutral. All right, to give us a transition tone there. We'll add a little bit of yellow ochre to it, and we can use that same color here on the beard. And we can come on over to the edge of the shadow. Neutral gray, yellow ochre. All right. And then finally, I'm going to go to a smaller brush and a brownish transition tone, brownish transition tone on the mustache. I'm going to use burnt umber and white. And let's go in here for that tone. We'll go right next to the deep shadow we put. We'll bring that down to the shadow on the upper lip. And we'll leave that light struck plane there. There's a touch of very whitish sort of gray mustache there. We'll add a little bit of white to our mixture so that where we come out, that's too much white. Let me go back for burnt umber. Just as simple a statement of the tone as we possibly can. And transition tones. Okay, some important one up on the turban. Let's do that now at the very top of the turban. I'm going to clean my brush off and take the lightest of my three neutrals. It has a little bit of flesh color on. There was a little bit of flesh color on the brush, which is not objectionable at all. Touch of blue. I suspect this man is out of doors, and the top of that turban is probably reflecting some light either from the sky or a building. And we'll come over here and we'll use that to get a soft edge, not a hard edge. And that will come around there. All right, now we have done the mosaic of halftones. Now we've got to take care of these remaining little chips in the mosaic. I think I'll just start at the top and work down. The highlight on the forehead there looks to me like white, yellow ochre, cadmium red light. That's the mixture I have right there. And I'm going to warm it up with a little bit of cadmium orange. Now let's just see what this looks like. It needs to be darker than that. More yellow ochre. I'm going to just dirty it up a little bit and put some all right, let's just see what this will look like. Better, let's try that. It's white, yellow ochre, cadmium red light, and then with cadmium orange mixed in with it. And I dirtied it a little bit by taking some of the bluish color from an earlier mixture. As I put this on, I realized that it's it's really darker than it should be, and it doesn't glisten as a moist highlight the way it should be. By moist, I mean the texture of the man's skin. So I'm going to clean my brush, go back to my light mixture, add a little bit more yellow ochre, and I'm going to lay this lightest tone on top. Much better. Now that gives us the feeling of a moist reflecting highlight, which is what we're trying. A man who is perspiring slightly in this hot sun. And I have to clean my brush and go lighter still for this highlight here and here. I'm just going to knock the edge off of that highlight with my finger, and perhaps to a degree right there. But I want those highlights to be fairly crisp if I can. Comes down that way and then that way, and there's a little bit of a stroke coming that way. I see that Sargent has blended this side of the highlights off into the tones of the forehead, so we'd better do the same. And while we have that color on the brush, we can indicate some of these other forms on the forehead. There's a little form right there that's catching the light. There's what people like to call a frown line right there. And another one right there. But let's go on down, and the same type of color, if I warm it up with just a little bit of cadmium red, should work for this area right under the eye. It's darker than the highlight, as you can see. It's darker by far than the highlight on the forehead. We'll blend that into the halftone. And this will give us the shape of the cheekbone, of the highlight, the lighted upper plane of that cheekbone. And after I brush that in, I get the same feeling as I did when we did the highlights on the forehead, that it needs to be pepped up, needs to be made lighter in value right there and also right there. Okay, continuing now with those the lightest lights on the face, the two little triangles of light there next to his nose, again, they're glistening highlights. I'm going to use my stick so it'd be a little more accurate. Now that's too bright a tone. I'm going to go down and add more yellow ochre. Now this is more like the stroke up on the forehead. And it's just an informal little triangle of tone there. Gives shape to the side of the nose. And then right below the nostril is a little triangle where the light strikes the upper plane of the upper lip, right above the mustache. It's mostly white and yellow ochre. And it gives, by the way, a very odd and sort of ragged edge to the nose, but that's the way Sargent has painted it, and we'll leave that for the time being. Probably now is the time to put the catch light on the tip of the nose, so I'm just going to take the color we've been using and add a bit of white to it, and I'm going to take my finger and blur that tone in now. And as I place the catchlight, I want to place it as a single stroke in the proper direction. And I don't want to have to fuss with it too much. That's a little bit brighter than it should be. I may have to tone that down. There's another highlight up here on the bridge of the nose, but I'm getting ahead of myself. I'm doing the main light struck tones, and let's go down and do the one on the lip. It's in the same sequence of these highlights: forehead, cheekbone, side of the nose. Now we're going down onto the lip. It's slightly darker and slightly warmer, and I've added a little bit of cadmium red to the mixture. And again, I'm going to obliterate the catchlight in order to put the plane that is there beneath the catchlight. We'll put that catchlight in later when we particularize the mouth. But I'll lay my maul stick down, and let's go back with these light struck tones. Let's go to the one on the mustache, the lightest area of the mustache, and I'm going to use burnt umber and white. It's a warm grayish tone, which gives us that transition. I think I'll go and put a little bit of this onto this plane right here. I know the plane is lighter than that, but I want to relieve some of the starkness there. And now I'm going to take a larger brush and do all of the light struck areas on the beard. It's basically white and black and yellow ochre, kind of a warmish gray tone. We'll come in here, up onto the mustache. We'll use this to transition into that dark. And these are very informal strokes. They go some down and some this way and some that way, just to get the tone off the brush onto the beard, where that is still the light toned ground of the canvas. We haven't actually put any color on that yet, and maybe the time has come to do that. A little bit more of this warm gray here on the turban. This warm gray links together all of these tones in this area. Let me just clean my brush off in the mineral spirits, and I'm going to take the lightest of my three neutrals. And all that is a mixture of white, black, has a little touch of yellow ochre in it to warm it up. And let's just see if that will work for the beard. No, it's much too light. So I'm going to go back and just dirty it up a little bit. And let's try it again. It's better, but I'm going to dull it down just a bit further. I don't want it to be stark white. All right, let's use that for the beard. And we'll drag it over the edge so there's a little bit of blending there. We'll run these strokes this way and drag the previous paint into the light tone as we do it. And then we'll go up and lighten it up for the lightest area on that beard, which is right there. And like that. Sargent's working with great big wide strokes here. He's not meticulously painting the hairs of the beard or anything like that. All right, continuing with the statement of the light tones, we need to deal with the highlights in the flesh areas of the rib cage, then the big areas of tone out here on the robe. And so let's do that now. I'm going to use the biggest brush I've got. I'm going to use white and yellow ochre, and I've brought in a little bit of cadmium orange. Let's just try that color out. It's okay for the lightest tones, but I need to put an overall tone behind there first, which is a touch darker. So I'm going to go up here, grab a little bit of neutral gray, and a little bit more of the yellow ochre and cadmium orange. Now this will not be the lightest highlight in this area. This will be sort of an overall tone behind the lightest light. About like that. And I'm trying to, if I can, capture the spirit of Sargent's brush work, which is extremely self-assured and rapid. He doesn't dwell over anything. He doesn't fuss over anything. And of course, that's very much more difficult than doing it in a slow and careful way. And that's basically the color of those light highlights. But let's take some additional white and a little bit of additional yellow ochre. And we want the final highlight, to be very thick and opaque if we can. We're even going to build it up a little bit if we can. And let's try this. The lightest highlight comes right along the shadow here, like that. And then there's a strong pile of light color right there, and a brush stroke that seems to go down here. That's pretty good, but I think I exaggerated the brusqueness of it. Let me do just a little bit of blending there to make it feel a little bit more like a man's chest, if I can. I think what I'm going to have to do is to go back in with some of the color that underlies that. So I'm going to take yellow ochre, touch of cadmium orange, and let me just go back in there to restate that little touch of Venetian red. This should make the highlights stand out even more. Go a little darker there and a little bit more color. Not trying to do it in a careful way. We're trying to do it in a bold, painterly way if we can. And then up in this area, do you see that there is a feeling here of the half tone coming around the edge of the collarbone there? And then over one of the ribs, sort of like that. And we don't want to get meticulous or fussy with it, because that would not be in keeping with the way the original is painted. But let's leave that for the moment. Wash off that big brush, and let's go out here onto the robe, where there is a very, very subtle passage of white and yellow. I'm going to use cadmium yellow for the first time. And let's try nope, it's too bright. Let me tone it down just a little bit with some of this neutral and some of the highlight color. And all of this is still too bright. Let's throw some neutral gray in it. The neutral gray always helps you to quickly subdue the intensity of it. That seems pretty good. All right, here's the tone on that shoulder. It is done in a very, very informal and indefinite way out here. Just a few strokes over toward the edge. What Sargent is trying, I'm gonna grab a little bit of cadmium orange. Sargent is trying to suggest the light striking the robe, and he wants it to look like it was executed in great haste, which I'm sure it was. I cleaned my brush and I'm picking up fresh white paint and cadmium yellow. I have seen the original painting in the museum in Boston, and that yellow passage on the robe is quite a bright flare of color there. Maybe not quite that brilliant. I mean, as in every other case, I'm just going to throw in a little bit of neutral gray to reduce the brilliance of that. Let's try it again. Still too strong. A little more neutral gray. Better. And let's just splash this on all the way down, and big strokes up and down and like so. And a touch of this here and there. And it's a wonderful, brilliant kind of canary yellow passage where it goes up onto the shoulder. It grays down. Let me put some yellow ochre in that. Grays down just slightly where it merges into that shadow. And we'll work out some kind of a little bit of transition between the two. Now, while I'm doing that, it occurs to me that some of that treatment is required up here on the turban. So let's take, it's not the brilliant yellow, it's a very subtle yellow. It's just really the yellow of an aged linen fabric in the sunlight. So I'm going to use black, white, cadmium yellow light, and just to get some of the yellow element up there, and some thick paint, some thick opaque paint. And we'll just sort of splash it on up there so that people looking at the original of this sketch will feel the texture of opaque paint up there. And as we put the strokes on, we just let the paint sort of be pulled out of the brush in a very thick way. And we'll do the same treatment over here on the turban right there. Just as thick a glob of heavy impasto paint as I can make the brush deposit there. Coming that way a little bit, and maybe down that fold just a little bit. And since we have it on the brush, maybe we could try a little bit of that right here in this little transition area, and also on the beard. All right, there are one or two small passages in the light areas that need to be attended to now, particularly on the beard. Let me show you what they are. Right here below the lower lip, there are two wonderful strokes that need to be made, but before we can do them, we need to darken this tone, and we need to very much darken this plane right here. Well, instead of darkening it, I lightened it. So let me push that down in tone. I'm going to use my stick to steady my hand. I want to push that down in tone. There. All right, and now taking a smaller brush and some fairly light gray color, I want to see if I can capture the character of the two strokes right here. One there and one there. All right. Highlights on the turban, highlight on the turban there, highlights on the beard. It seems to me that we've completed our light toned passages. Yes, we have. And now we come to a real important point in the painting. I have pretty much covered the canvas with a mosaic of tones, the shadow tones, the half tones, the light tones, and the thing is beginning to take shape. But now what we need to do is what I call the restating step. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to go back over the whole painting in the same order that I did it the first time. And I'm going to restate everything. I'm going to restate the darks. I'm going to restate the halftones. I'm going to restate the lights. I know that sounds tedious. It won't be. It'll be very rapid. But the restating step is an important point where you sort of take a deep breath and you take a look at the picture, and you're able, now that you have a lot of tones on the canvas, you're able to judge your tones a little better. You're able to judge your drawing a little better. This restating step is real important. All right. The restating step. We want to go back to where we started in the first place, which was in the dark shadows on the face. We'll just have a look at what we've done, and my only feeling is that perhaps we could warm that shadow up. I'm going to take the original mixture, which is still here on the palette, and I'm going to add a little bit of alizarin crimson and burnt sienna, and toward the bottom part of this deep shadow on the face. Even though it is very difficult to see any real variations in Sargent's shadow, I'm going to sort of invent some. It'll warm the shadow up a little bit and just make it a little bit more lively. And we'll drag some of the color from the beard up into that shadow. As if there was a, we're painting that now as if there was a reflected light on that cheekbone that we just can't pick up in the original painting. And with that thought in mind, we'll go down and do some of the same here, right beneath the lower lip. Again, it doesn't show in the original, but it may very well be there. Just not vividly clear in the reproduction that I'm looking at as I paint this. And I'm putting a little bit of warm tone in the shadow of the upper lip. Now, looking at the other dark shadows, it occurs to me that I can go darker in the on the beard here. I'm going to add a little bit of black to the neutral gray. There's a very subtle transition between the flesh and the beard there. I'm going to also narrow the width of that beard a little bit. I don't want that lower portion of the face and beard to get to be too wide. All right, looking into the shadows, I see something I hadn't noticed the first time, and that is that there is just a touch of reflected light up here in the shadow on the turban, and I'm going to use cadmium red for it. It helps to reveal a suggestion of another fold there that I couldn't, that I didn't see the first time. All right, still looking at the shadows, restating the shadows. I'm going to go a touch stronger there and a little touch stronger right there. This shadow down here, the shadow on his shoulder, seems like I can go with what I have, but I'm going to mix the color anyway and come over here and just make a stroke or two with the brush there and there, and a couple of strokes like that into the shadow. And maybe with my finger, I'll just take some of the paint off of that, the darkest part of that shadow. All right, let's say that's a restating of the shadow tones. How about a restating of the half tones? And I began the painting of the half tones in these transition tones along the shadow. Let's look at that. I can go slightly darker here. Touch darker. All right, on the nose, I can add a little bit of color, and I can think about the drawing of the shape of the nose there while I restate those transition halftones. And right here on the bridge of the nose, I realize I need to go a touch darker and a little more reddish. I'm going to use some Venetian red. All right. Restating the darks. I see that I can increase the width of that eyebrow there. The restating the transition halftones, or any halftone for that matter. I see that I can go slightly darker on the top of the brow ridge there, just a touch darker. And the same thing there and up there. All right, now coming down into this big, important area of warm color there, I see that there are some variations that have to be made. The first one is that there is some cool reflected light on the underside of that cheekbone that will make that very hot color a little bit grayer. Let me try that now. Yeah, I'm introducing a little bit of sort of a steel gray into the, and as I come down toward the beard, I'm going to lighten it and add a bit of yellow. Not only will this give me a little bit more form, a little bit more contour there, but it will reduce the brilliance of the color there, which is necessary. All right, and then over in this triangle of color, it just simply needs to be a little bit lighter in value than it is there. Than it is now. It needs to be grayed down a touch and made a touch lighter. And maybe we can affect a little bit of a transition between those two tones. Just before we reach the beard, the tone needs to lighten up. And we'll soften that edge. Okay. Transition tones. Then down here in the area of the upper lip, let me restate that tone on the lower lip. It got a little dirty. All right. And I think that maybe now is the time to put that catch light on the lower lip. I'm going to take the same bright mixture that I used for the catch light on the nose, only it's not quite so bright. And let's do the catch light on that lower lip, right about like so. And there's another one just below it that runs that way. So I'm restating half tones. Let's look at the at a restating of the lightest tones now. Perhaps that highlight on the forehead that we changed several times. Maybe we could lighten that just one stage lighter still. But the lesson of this section is to don't become impatient and don't miss the value of this important restating step. It's where you go back and look at everything that you've done and challenge yourself on it. Should that tone be a little lighter, a little darker? Should the drawing be adjusted this way or that way? For example, I suddenly see that I can adjust the drawing of the beard on this side by just coming in on that white area a bit and making the beard less wide from side to side. So we've restated the darks, the half tones, many of the light tones are transition tones. Okay, we come now to the concluding steps of this painting, and what I want to do now is go into the features of the face. And even though this painting is a very loose and direct style of painting, whatever detail we're going to put in, we're going to put in now. Looking at the eyes first. The thing that catches the eye first is that bright highlight, bright kind of moist highlight in this eye. And I'm mixing that color right now. It's just white and black, and I'm trying to get it to the value that it should be. And Sargent appears to have put it in with just a single stroke there. And it gives the Arab gentleman a slightly sort of wild-eyed, fierce look in the eye, but that's the mood of the painting. I can see some small details that we can add. One is a slight dark here under the eye. It's just a touch darker than the tone that we painted it on. That same color we can use right there in the corner of the eye. And as we've noted all along, Sargent's intention was not to paint detail. This is a rapid study. That iris, as I look over at the original, has essentially no detail in it. So we'll leave our version the same. Going over here, looking at the other eye, there's even less detail. And I'm going to take that original mixture of burnt umber, alizarin crimson, and black, and just make this shadow tone in the eye even more dense and dark. All we see of the eye here is a suggestion right there of the iris in this dark shadow. And the forms beneath the eye, we see just suggestively. They're not explicit details. And it adds a sort of mystery. I'm going to wipe that brush off and take a color that will fit in with this shadow. And there are a few mysterious strokes in that shadow of maybe forms of the face catching the light. They're sort of random strokes here. It might be highlights on ridges of paint, I'm not sure. But I can see them in the reproduction of the painting that I'm looking at. And we'll just put them in and knock the edge of them a little bit off and leave them. There's a mysterious little detail down there. And there's a mysterious little detail there. But that is all the detail that I can see in the eyes. Looking at the nose, as far as touches that we can add, I'm not sure that there's a great deal to be added and still preserve the loose, direct feel. On the side of the highlight, there is a plane that could go just a touch darker. Let me see if I can indicate that. Just a touch darker to emphasize the highlight a bit more. And I think we could add a little bit of color on this side of the highlight on the nose. There's no drawing to speak of over here in the nostril. There's a little bit of darker color coming out of the eye socket and down onto the nose. But I think basically if we just leave the nose for what it is, a statement of halftones, a halftone on the side, a ridge of highlights, and then a darker halftone, and then the deep shadow, then we'll be faithful to Sargent's concept. In the area of the mouth, first of all, in the mustache, I'm going to add just a little bit of detail. There is a little bit of gray that we can add into the mustache, just here and there. A little bit more texture. In the matter of the upper lip, which in most portraits is a troubling and difficult thing to paint, in this case it's so simple, I'm just going to add a little bit of warm color, a little bit of cadmium red, just to make it a little more vivid in color. All right, we're just fussing a little bit with the upper lip, adding some Venetian red. There's a bit of deep, warm, reflected light over here in the shadow side. And that is basically it. All of this area of the upper lip is lost in shadow. Looking at the lower lip, I think all we need to do is to simplify the forms here under the highlight. Make it go a little bit more, make the form go a little bit more in the direction of the highlight. And we'll change the color on the brush and go up above the highlight and just simplify that plane there a little bit. And once again, the mouth does not present any meticulous details that we need to treat. We could change the shape of the shadow at the corner of the mouth just a bit, and that'll also alter the expression just a bit. We'll come down and then in. And I don't want to lose the depth of the shadow, so let me just restate that. Quite dark. And the little form that begins to come out of the shadow into the halftone area. And it needs to come up a little bit, or the lip will appear too thick. All right, looking at finishing touches that we can make, it occurs to me that there is an important highlight in the area of the neck. Here is the sternomastoid muscle, and as it attaches here to the collarbone, Sargent has placed a highlight there. Needs to be stronger than that. About like that. And once that's in place, I realize that the halftone just to the left of that area needs to be slightly darker and a little bit wider in shape. And let me see if I can simplify that area a little bit. All right, then coming on down, it seems to me that this big important shadow in the where the robe, the neckline of the robe casts on the flesh needs to be warmed up with some, speaking of that one, I'm going to add some Venetian red in there just to make it a little more vivid. And we'll come down and make that a slightly bigger shape. And cleaning the brush off a little bit and adding more cadmium orange. Over here on the light side of that stroke, let's just simplify the contour. Well, we're at the stage where we don't want to continue so far that we begin to lose the character of the painting, of the original painting, which is bold and direct and loose. And we don't want to lose that element. So one way you can judge the painting when you're at a finishing point is to try it in a frame. And I'm going to slip a frame on it, and we'll just see how that looks. Well, it may not be perfect. I'm sure it's not. But it's a valuable study, and I think we'll end at that point.